This video was made possible through the support of my patrons.
Hey folks, now you've seen the video title. You know that we're going to be talking about the Ninth Doctor as played by Christopher Eccleston in the realm of Big Finish audio dramas, but I wanted to start this video off on a slightly different note. You see, my wife, she doesn't really care about Doctor Who. It's okay, I've learned to forgive her. However, she knows that I love Doctor Who, and I love the Ninth Doctor specifically. So when it was announced a year ago that Christopher Eccleston would be joining the cast of Big Finish to star in a range of audio box sets, well, my wife went behind my back and surprised me with this. She knew how excited I was, she knew how hyped I was, and even though I normally get the digital ones, she went out of her way to get this collector's edition hard copy box set. And I thought it was such a lovely gesture. She got this for my birthday. I've been waiting for ages to unbox this for the camera. I thought it was such a lovely gesture that I'd open it for the start of this video and let you folks know what is inside this box.
Hello, I'm the Doctor. Hey, what's going on round here?
Yeah, it's worth remembering that while everyone is extremely hyped and excited about Christopher Eccleston returning to the role of the Ninth Doctor after over 15 years in a range of Big Finish audio dramas, that wasn't the character's first foray into the audio medium. No, in fact, due to it basically being a given for several years that Eccleston would never return to the franchise, Big Finish took the liberty of telling more stories with this incarnation. So what we're going to do in this episode of The Trip of a Lifetime is go through these releases, you know, eating your vegetables before we can get to the main attraction, which would be dessert in this tortured analogy. First story to feature the Ninth Doctor was 2013's Night of the Whisper, written by Kevin Scott and Mark Wright, directed by John Owensworth. It was one of 11 other releases as part of the Destiny of the Doctor 50th anniversary range, where every month in 2013, Big Finish would release an audiobook in association with Audio Go for each Doctor 1 through 11. And Night of the Whisper was the Ninth Doctor story released in September. Narrated by Nicholas Briggs and following the Doctor, Rose and Captain Jack, we find them on a distant moon in the 23rd century in the crime-ridden city of New Vegas, infiltrating an organized crime sect, trying to discover the identity of the mysterious vigilante, the Whisper.
Crop burger with extra cheese for table four.
The plate of food was slipped across the polished metal serving pass.
Tyler, table four.
Rose Tyler had been miles away, remembering running hand in hand with the Doctor across the luminous sands of Slavia. He'd promised her the trip of a lifetime. What had she got? A waitressing job in a sleazy 23rd century casino on New Vegas. He was going to get such a slap when she saw him.
Honestly, just cutting right to the chase, this release didn't do much for me. Maybe it was having to do with having listened to three other audiobooks recently with the Doctor, Rose and Jack, which were much better, but I think a big part of it is the story structure. We find our TARDIS trio already mid-mission, and to be honest, we don't even really know why they're there in the first place, other than, it's Doctor Who, we need a story this week. Rose is working as a waitress in a criminal bar, Jack is pretending to be a reporter for the Daily Galaxy, and the Doctor has somehow infiltrated the police station, which, to be fair, leads to a great introduction to the Doctor in this story. We have a lot of action set pieces and fights, which is kind of surprising, given its relatively short runtime, but there's very little audience investment in the world and its inhabitants, because we've just been plopped into it in medias res. The emotional epicenter of the story is meant to focus on Police Chief McNeil, voiced here by John Schwab, but he's such a blank slate of a character who the Doctor only tries to save because the 11th Doctor appears on a large TV screen in the city halfway through the story and just tells him that's what he has to do. That's the Ninth Doctor's motivation in this story. His future self just tells him what to do.
Now, I haven't got long, and before you have a go, yes, I know this is breaking several laws of time, but this is important, extremely important. Listen to me. McNeil must live. Yes, yes, I know he's a misguided idiot, but when he becomes the mayor of New Vegas, he... Well, that's for me to know and you to find out. Mum's the word. Just make sure nothing happens to him, okay? Cheers, ears.
Then he was gone. The screen once again showing two aliens knocking chunks out of each other.
What was that about?
Rose asked.
He was talking about McNeil.
I heard, the doctor said, getting back to work. He winced as he heard the screen fizz again.
Sorry about the ears thing, by the way.
The bow tie wearing idiot said, his face creased in concern.
Just something Pond used to say. Nothing personal.
Fantastic, the doctor muttered. It was the first time Rose had ever heard him say it with a complete lack of enthusiasm.
Night of the Whisper really struggles with the lack of any sort of morality as to whether or not the Doctor should try and save McNeil, as his actions and motives are revealed over the course of the story. There's just no tension to it. The Doctor acts uncharacteristically angry and outlandishly aggressive towards McNeil because we need to contrive a will-he-or-won't-he third act as to whether or not the Doctor will heed his 11th incarnation's advice. But there's no bite to it. We know what he's going to do. There's no tension here. Jack and Rose have very little to do here as well, but Jack's removal from the plot leads itself to some really funny banter. Kevin Scott and Mark Wright really captured Captain Jack's voice. But apart from that, you know, at least after nearly a decade, The Long Game actually has some competition now as the weakest Ninth Doctor story. This one gets a thumbs down from me. Next up is, and I can't believe I'm saying this, I can't believe I'm diving into this, the Winston Churchill box set, The Churchill Years from 2016, directed by Ken Bentley and narrated by Ian McNeice, who reprises his role as Winston Churchill from Series 5 and Series 6. The box set has four stories, but we're mainly going to be focusing on the first one, The Oncoming Storm by Phil Mulrine, which has Churchill in 1939 at the start of World War II, and an alien weapon has washed up on the shores of the Thames that could turn the tide in the conflict, but has devastating mental effects on whoever touches it. A group of AI called rats are in pursuit of the weapon, but we also have the Ninth Doctor skulking about in the shadows, trying his best to prevent Churchill from getting involved.
But those things are dangerous.
I know, he said. They were about to start erasing bits of you before I distracted them, honestly. Some people are never pleased.
But there are people in Admiralty House.
Like who, he asked?
Like Winston Churchill.
The Doctor froze, then scowled, then muttered something about forgetting he'd be there at this point, about not wanting to get involved at such a key point in history.
What does that mean? You're isolationist, is that it? Listen, those rat things can kill Mr. Churchill.
The Doctor drew his screwdriver out again and casually flicked the device off. That would deactivate the stone again, he said, confusing the rats, delaying them. They may have a fix on the building, but not the stone's exact location. And they'd have to devise an assault plan.
Then we have time to get to Admiralty House to warn them.
The Doctor hesitated.
Come on!
But still he didn't move, apparently torn between conflicting desires.
You don't want to get involved? Fine. Stay skulking in the shadows, but I'm going.
And go she did, leaving the Doctor staring after her.
First things first, Ian McNeice does a great job with the narration and playing Churchill. The guy has played the definitive wartime leader on TV and stage numerous times. He brings his A-game here. He's really good. Here's the thing, though. There has been some discourse in recent years about the rose-tinted glasses and sugarcoating of Churchill's political career. Yeah, he's an icon who also sells car insurance, but he also committed terrible atrocities and held outdated opinions even by his generation standards. If you're wanting acknowledgement of a more nuanced depiction of Churchill, I'd argue that you're never going to get it from a show like Doctor Who. It's just not built for that purpose. but you definitely won't get it in this box set because it reads as a four-part fellatio to Winston Churchill, where everyone talks about how amazing he is, how noble and strong and brave he is as a person, let alone his importance as a symbol. Supporting characters literally stop the plot just to talk about his brilliant character. There's a device in one story in this box set that increases someone's intelligence, but it also destroys their minds, and people actually say, "Churchill, even a mind as smart and as incredible as yours couldn't handle it." In the second story, The Tenth Doctor Encounter, a creature latches onto Churchill, and it's not the final reason that we're given, but the initial one. The reason that we are initially given as to why it's latched onto Churchill is because Churchill is apparently just so gosh darned awesome. So of course the creature would bond with him. I'm not making that up, it almost reads as parody. But here's the rub though. The framing device of the box set is that it's Churchill recounting these events from his perspective. So in a way, the comical self-aggrandizing wartime stories about Winston are by Winston. It's the narrative equivalent of the "and then everyone on the train clapped" meme. Though I feel like that could be me playing devil's advocate, I don't know what the objective of the box set was when it comes to this characterization. And with the Ninth Doctor in the oncoming storm, he's just skulking around in the shadows for a reason that's never actually given. He just yells at Churchill for getting involved with alien tech, but never really takes any measures to take control of the situation. And when Churchill gets cornered by one of the AI, he's on his own in the basement of the building, he stands his ground, and he gives a speech, and then the Doctor just steps out from the shadows and says, "Oh, Winston, I wasn't sure if I was going to save the universe or not, but you're so awesome, you've inspired me to step in." It's absolutely nuts, and because we never see or hear the Ninth Doctor removed from Churchill or his assistant Hetty's perspective, we never learn what his deal is. Like, why isn't he stepping in? Like, this isn't the War Doctor, this is Nine. This is out of character for him. You could argue that it's pre-Rose, but even before he met with Rose, like, when he's in the building of the shopping department and he meets Rose for the first time, he's still getting involved, he's still blowing up the building, he's still stopping the aliens, even before he actually takes Rose Tyler's hand and says run. Anyway, this box set is interesting, but it's completely nuts. The best story is the third one, Living History, where the 11th Doctor takes Churchill back in time to meet Julius Caesar and encounters a Dalek there who has become known as the Bronze God by the ancient Britons. It's actually a really cool story, but do you want to know who else is along for the adventure? Seriously, like, just pause the video for a second, don't Google it, guess. I want you to write it in the comments what your guess was. Wrong, it was Kazran Sardik. This is one of the trips that he and the 11th Doctor take off screen during A Christmas Carol. Danny Horn even reprises the role. This feels like the epitome of a dartboard approach to storytelling. Okay, let's see, 11th Doctor, Winston Churchill, Daleks, and Kazran. Who put Kazran Sardik on the board? And to round off the box set, episode 4 has Lily Arwell, all grown up, the young girl from The Doctor, the Widow, and the Wardrobe, still played by Holly Earle. Okay, apparently she cares for Winston Churchill during his retirement, so that's a thing. Anyway, that's enough of the Churchill years. Let's take a look at the next big finish appearance for the Ninth Doctor, which is The Churchill Years Volume 2. Yes, they made another, and this one is just as mad. Thankfully, though, the parodic hero worship of Churchill is drastically toned down, and it's a much more consistently solid box set. Part 1 is a bit of a weak start, though. A young Winston, who's just not nearly as interesting a character, meets Madame Vastra, played by Niamh McIntosh. But it's with episodes 2 and 3 where the Ninth Doctor gets involved again, where the box set really finds its feet. Human Conflict by Ian McLaughlin has an alien arms dealer come to Earth offering incredible alien technologies to both the Axis and the Allies, with the Ninth Doctor trying to prevent mutually assured destruction, something that feels way more in character for this particular incarnation than his distanced approach in the last box set. And when the Doctor's ideology clashes with Churchill's desperation to win the war at any cost, it results in some really strong exchanges.
"This man was in Denmark, sir, at the weapons site."
"I'm sure he was, Lieutenant. Those piercing blue eyes glared at me intensely. I told you to leave it to me, Winston," he raged. "Now men are dead on both sides. That didn't have to happen. But I would not be bowed by my old friend. Doctor, this is war. Men are dying every day. Men and women and children. I must stop it. There is always an unfathomable quality to the doctor. His rage mixed with regret and empathy. He understood my need to bring the war to an end. But he would not change his stance. Using the biggest weapon you can find is not the answer, he said. I've seen it. I've done it. It doesn't take the guilt away. But I would not be swayed either. Perhaps. But if it saves a life, then I shall do it. You are a dear and trusted friend, Doctor. But you must understand my position.
I do. I really do, he insisted. And I believed him.
One thing I really appreciated about the second release, as opposed to the first one, is that it does show Churchill in a more negative light, as he's so desperate to win the war that it seriously compromises his judgment, and this box set goes about exploring that. Then the third story of this release, I Was Churchill's Double by Alan Barnes, goes absolutely off the cliff in terms of story concepts, and follows, and I'm not making a word of this up, Winston Churchill being sent to a multiverse where Germany has occupied Britain and Churchill is now a freedom fighter in 1942, wanted by the Reich, with the Ninth Doctor along for the ride.
I am not making this shit up!
And the reason Churchill is wanted is because the version of him originally from that universe had nuclear weapons blueprints in his memory, which he can only access through hypnotizing himself by watching the 1960s Doctor Who title sequence.
Again, not making this shit up!
It's nuts, and to be honest, the Ninth Doctor really is just a bystander in this story. He's mainly there to get across the exposition about multiverses and alternate timelines and stuff. It's utterly insane, though, and I love it. The fourth and final story, written by Robert Kahn and Tom Selinski, is a fun post-war VE Day romp with the Tenth Doctor called Churchill Victorious, so clearly a prequel to Time Lord Victorious. But you know what? I'll leave these other stories for another time. If you want to listen to any of these Churchill box sets, listen to the second one, but Living History from the first one is really good as well. So those volumes were absolutely mad. Let's go for something a bit more down to earth, and it's here that we find The Ninth Doctor Chronicles, released in May 2017, directed by Helen Goldwyn and narrated by Nicholas Briggs. In all seriousness, that skit at the beginning of the video, my wife didn't get this. I bought this. I got this off eBay for a couple of quid, but I didn't know this when I ordered it. It's brand new. It's factory sealed. Like, this has not been touched or used. Like, someone wanted rid of this thing. But yeah, this is the second ever, like, hard copy of a Big Finish release I ever got. I bought Sirens of Time on eBay for a couple of quid, like, 10 years ago. But I've actually bought a, you know, a boxed copy. And you know what? I should maybe do this more often, but I've got so many digital ones now with, like, oh, this is difficult. Difficult decisions. But yeah, this is beautiful. This actually looks really cool. I'm very happy with this. Blimey, imagine if my wife had got me the vinyl version. Ninth Doctor Chronicles, narrated by Nicholas Briggs on vinyl. I bought this thing brand new, but there doesn't seem to be any sort of, like, code or anything for me to get it on the app, so I'm guessing that there just isn't one for this release. Much like the other releases so far, it's a partially narrated, partly acted set of stories, as opposed to full cast audio dramas, with the first one, The Bleeding Heart by Cavan Scott, being the earliest Ninth Doctor story in his personal timeline that we know of so far. It's so early for him that he still has the War Doctor's sonic screwdriver. On the planet of peace, Galen, two warring races gather for a peace treaty signing, only for a murder to take place and disrupt the diplomacy. The Ninth Doctor, fresh from the Time War, is on the case and finds an unwitting ally in Adriana Jarsdell from Cosmic Nine News, played by Claire Wyatt. We also have her cameraman Stan, whose eye has been replaced with a camera, which really impresses the Doctor.
The stranger turned back to face her, looking as though he was about to tell her that she hadn't a clue what she was talking about, until he noticed Stan, and his eyes went wide.
Look at you! You're fantastic!
Stan took an involuntary step back as the man lunged forward to take a closer look at the cameraman's implant.
I've seen some cybernetics in my time, but that takes the biscuit.
Stan, the cameraman provided, shooting a nervous glance at Adriana, as the stranger pulled a cylindrical device from his pocket and proceeded to run the red light at its tip across Stan's face.
Pleased to meet you, Stan.
I'm the doctor.
Hey, what are you doing?
You're broadcasting with that thing.
Hey, I'm talking to you.
I know that this box set will be one of the main attractions for this video, but I honestly didn't have many thoughts on this story. Nicholas Briggs makes a game effort out of impersonating the Ninth Doctor, but I feel that at this point, the Ninth Doctor being hurt from the Time War and encountering almost perfect parallels or ironic fallout from the war itself feels really played out by this point, and while The Bleeding Heart has a killer third act, the journey it takes to get there is pretty bog standard. Adriana is basically a different character from scene to scene based on the needs of the plot, with several conflicting personality traits, which makes it kind of hard to warm to her as a companion surrogate. It's not a bad story, far from it, but it feels very, like, generic pre-Rose Ninth Doctor story. It's like what you'd get if an algorithm made it. I feel like there's more interesting things to do with this incarnation at this point in his life, but as an opener to this Chronicles box set, it gets the job done. Also, I do think that the writing doesn't help, but it feels like these Chronicles are just copying and pasting all the quirks and retorts and dialogue from Series 1, instead of doing something more novel and interesting with the Ninth Doctor. Something I feel really comes across in the second story, Una McCormack's The Window on the Moor, where some lines are just directly ripped from Russell T. Davis and Stephen Moffat, to the point where it gets quite distracting. But anyway, the Ninth Doctor, this time joined by Rose, land on a world where there's a civil war taking place between a Duke and a Prince, which also involves dimensional gateways that lead to Earth, where Rose and the Duke encounter Emily Bronte, randomly, in the 19th century. If you're wondering what on Earth those plot points have in common, I've no idea apart from the cursory mention of a love story in the mist, with the mist being the form that these portals take, and also drawing some allusions to Wuthering Heights, which, full disclosure, is a book I never liked. But anyway, I did like the setup to the story as the Doctor and Rose land in a seemingly deserted town as its residents hide away in their houses. It's when the Ninth Doctor gets imprisoned by the Duke, however, where things get way more interesting, leading to a legitimately inspired set piece in a dungeon with moving glass walls that even takes the Doctor by surprise as he's being pursued by a vicious creature.
The Doctor sped along the corridor, the beast giving chase, until the corridor ran out. He turned to face the monster, scrabbling in his pocket for his sonic screwdriver.
Now, you better watch out, or I'm not sure what I'll do.
The Doctor looked around worriedly.
I really am not sure at all.
The walls shifted again.
Hey, that was clever. Nothing to do with me, but clever.
The walls were curving inwards, hourglass style, pulling ever closer until eventually they met, forming a solid block between the Doctor and the beast.
Right. That's good. Unexpected, but good.
The story is exposition heavy as the Doctor and Rose land towards the end of this civil war and they need to be brought up to speed on a lot of details, meaning it's a bit hard for the supporting cast to really define themselves outside of the stock archetypes, but I think for the Prince that was kind of meant to be the point. Thankfully, the narration and McCormack's description of facial expressions and posture really goes a long way to closing that gap between the characters and the listener. I don't have too much to say about this story, to be honest. I think I like it more than I'm letting on. I'm glad that despite the main plot point being this civil war, the Doctor doesn't really go existential and start yelling about war being the worst and 10 million ships on fire, and you know, he's being really melancholic because that feels so played out by this point. It's a decent story, I did like it. Next up we have The Other Side by Scott Hancock, and I need to correct a statement I made in a video a while back.
And you know that Adam Mitchell is so bad that even Big Finish won't touch him.
Yeah, turns out I was wrong. Big Finish had actually told a story with Adam Mitchell. Heck, they even brought Bruno Langley back to reprise the role. However, this was recorded and released before all of that stuff came out about him. Oh god, oh, look at this image of Nicholas Briggs next to Bruno Langley, and Nicholas Briggs does not look happy at all. Yeah, Nicholas Briggs, he knows what's up. Anyway, this story directly follows off from the events of Dalek, when Adam Mitchell steps inside the TARDIS in Van Staten's Alien Museum in Utah in 2012. The Doctor tries to take him home to Manchester, but an issue in the time vortex causes them to land someplace else.
And we're underground, I think.
How can you tell? Asked Rose.
There's just something about the atmosphere. You get used to it after a while. But there's this tang to the air, a coolness. A bit like damp. And the acoustics. Listen. Hello? Rose Tyler. You see? Dead quiet. Soundproofed. which suggests to me that we're definitely underground somewhere. So an inhospitable environment, perhaps? A space base on Mars or something?
Hey, 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 what's all the racket in aid of?
The Doctor stormed out of the TARDIS, clearly unimpressed.
You lot, you'll wake the neighbours.
Rose began to explain.
Adam was just trying to work out where we've landed. He thinks we might be on Mars.
Somewhere inhospitable, anyway.
Well, you're not that far off, and neither are we. This is Birmingham, 2012. I'm afraid that tsunami in the vortex gave the TARDIS a bit of a battering.
Birmingham?
Birmingham, yes, that's right. Only slightly off course, you can catch a train to take you back up north. Saved you a heap on an airfare.
They're actually in an abandoned cinema, which is the centre of some strange temporal phenomena, which is causing the cinema screening room to decay, chair row by chair row. Cool setting, cool premise. Here's the issue, though, and it goes back to what I was saying earlier. We've basically got a Doctor here going through the motions as a character. In the other side, we've got a threat, which is a species thought to be wiped out in the Time War that possess human bodies, so, you know, we have the Gelth from the Unquiet Dead. We have one of Rose's boyfriend companions, who the Doctor and Rose relay instructions to by phone, like Mickey in World War III, and then we have the climax, where these creatures hold Rose hostage and demand the Doctor open a locked door to ensure her survival, which literally happened one episode ago in Dalek from the character's perspective. Now, the atmosphere is good, Briggs does a great job narrating, and you know what? Credit where it's due, Bruno Langley does alright here. Even though Adam really has no thematic purpose in this story, like, why did this story need to have Adam in it? It feels like a novelty which could potentially devalue what happened to him in the long game, especially since the episode ends with an open ending, with the Doctor being pretty happy with his work, which could allow for more stories with Adam to take place, which has, that's aged badly.
No, no, no. Credit where it's due. You kept your cool, did a brilliant job. And who knows? You might even be able to show Rose a thing or two. One day.
One day. But I thought this was goodbye?
Who needs goodbyes when you've got a time machine? But what do you reckon, Rose? Shall we take him once around the block before going home?
Rose smiled.
Your ship, your rules.
Wait, are you... you serious?
Not if I can help it.
The Doctor unlocked the TARDIS. Then he stepped aside, waving his two companions in through the open doors.
Come on then, Adam Mitchell. Trip of a lifetime. Let's see what your future has in store.
I have to go now. My planet needs me.
Wow.
Adam Mitchell.
Came from another planet? I guess. Mm.
But you know what? There was one awesome thing I liked in this story, and it revolves around the Doctor getting thrown back in time to the same location, the same cinema, but without a TARDIS and by over a century, in the 1890s, where the cinema is a theatre. Then, Rose gets thrown back following him into 1922, when the theatre is now a nightclub. The Doctor then waits in his respective time period for 28 years, and then goes back to the nightclub on January 1st, 1922, and stays there, night after night, because he knows this is the year that Rose is going to show up in. It's a wonderful character beat, and I love how it's portrayed. It's a great building upon the Doctor and Rose's relationship from the TV show, because she never really considered the Doctor being relatively ageless as a Time Lord. It's so in character, it gives us something that Series 1 never did, and I loved it. It was a wonderful moment in an otherwise ho-hum story that kind of spins its wheels with better material and doesn't have much of a reason to exist. Now, I went into the fourth and final story of this box set with low expectations, to be honest, after the previous three. We have Retail Therapy, written by James Goss, where the Ninth Doctor and Rose return to the Powell Estate and visit Jackie Tyler, here once again played by Camille Kadjouri. And Jackie has basically been roped into a pyramid scheme, where the hot new craze are Glubby Glubs, a pink squishy stress ball. However, their results are miraculous, apparently. Jackie's looking years younger, losing weight, and is making a lot of money. But the Doctor suspects alien intervention, so the investigation begins. Now, with that premise, you might expect a fluff contemporary story. It's certainly what I expected. However, and I can't believe I'm saying this, the Ninth Doctor adventure, where Jackie Tyler is selling Glubby Glubs, is by far and away the best Ninth Doctor Big Finish story pre-Eccleston. Now, hold on, stay with me here.
The Doctor leaned closer to the tray.
They're so odd. A
and they're humming. Can't you hear it? Of course you can't, humans. You've got such limited hearing, no wonder dogs take pity on you.
He patted down his pockets, looking for his sonic screwdriver. Rose shook her head.
Don't bother, she said. It's not an alien invasion, it's just naff. We just get crazies for things, it's human. It's nice to see Mum having a project, being a success, even if it is flogging stuff to the neighbours. What do they call those parties? Tupper?
Nuh-uh-uh, we don't use that word, sweetheart. Mind out for the tray. No, Glubby Glubs are very hot on branding. We don't mention rival products, or if we do, we talk about parties to sell plastic storage containers. It's a bit of a fiddle, but you'll soon get the hang of it.
What works so well about this story, aside from its great social commentary about pyramid schemes, is that it really hones into how Jackie Tyler perceives the Ninth Doctor and his relationship with her daughter. Yeah, there's an alien threat to stop as the Glubby Glubs are sucking the life energy out of the people Jackie is selling them to, but for the most part, it's a background detail, where Jackie, having not been able to give Rose a life of travelling and adventure because of their life below the poverty line, she feels intensely jealous that the Doctor can show up one day and just effortlessly give her that life with apparently no ulterior motive. Jackie is a bit suspicious of that, but also gets upset that a get-rich-quick scheme that is actually paying off for her, the Doctor is interfering and potentially could sabotage it all. It's a lovely look at this dynamic that we never got in the TV series, and it's where I think expanded media like Big Finish can really shine and pick up the slack. But that's not to say it's all glum character building, because we need to talk about James Goss, and I adore how Goss characterises the Ninth Doctor. The dourness and intimidation that has permeated most of these Big Finish stories, it's gone in favour of a much more cheerful, charming, but still down-to-earth and serious when necessary, Doctor who is trying to do right by Rose and is not sure how to navigate Jackie. As far as I'm aware, this is the only Ninth Doctor story that James Goss has written outside of Time Lord Victorious appearances, but I would love him to do more because he's hit it out of the park here. There's also a brilliant, subtle reference to the Christmas Invasion, which is the audible equivalent of Blink and You'll Miss It. The script is littered with wonderful details like that.
Ketchup! The Doctor and Rose were in a cafe, eating breakfast. It was clearly one of the Doctor's rare peace offerings.
Don't think buying me a bacon sandwich makes it all okay, said Rose, taking a bite.
Bacon? There are planets that don't have bacon. Worlds have been invaded because of the lack of it.
You're kidding. I mean, bacon? Is it worth fighting for?
Ask a pig.
The Doctor was making spirals on his plate with the sauce bottles.
People always want something that isn't theirs.
I can never work out which is my favourite. I would say ketchup, but then how would I look brown sauce in the eye again? Did you have a good night's sleep?
Yeah. What about you and my mum? You were out late together.
Oh, we talked. Listen that.
The Doctor dabbed a corner of bread in a little red sauce, a little brown.
She's trying so hard, she really is, to like you, to make a success of things.
For those Glubby Glubs.
Are evil pink balls of squishy evil.
Totally. You want another bacon sandwich?
Nah. Let's go fight evil.
And best of all, the story never loses sight of the larger term stakes though, with the Glubby Glubs, such as how they're impacting the people that Jackie is selling them to, their impact on the Doctor, Rose, and even the TARDIS. The climax of the story is genuinely suspenseful, and I did not see the ending confrontation coming. This story really takes you for a ride. It's a cliche term, but it really was the full package. I loved it from beginning to end. It fits right in with Russell T. Davis's view of the show, especially its vehement anti-capitalist subtext, which in retail therapy basically becomes just the text, as the Glubby Glubs become a metaphor for the parasitic nature of capitalism, pyramid schemes, and the usually innocent phrase, thank you for your time, takes on such a dark meaning in this story. Also, props to this episode, I guess, for literally saying that the 1% are terrible and bad. Like, it's that on the nose. Russell T. Davis would be proud. Camille Cajori is great, by the way. It was lovely to hear her slip back into this role.
The thing is, I don't want you to be right. I hate it when you're right. Mums have a role in life. They protect their daughters. And when they meet a man, we watch them like hawks. We may like them, we may just put up with them, but we watch them and we know what to expect. You're different. No, wait. I know that you're not, you know, like that. Are you? No, never mind. But here it is, you're offering her everything I never could. I made ends meet. There were birthday presents and the Christmas club and so on. But travel, adventure, exotic holidays, forget it. My whole life has been about making do. And you, you idiot, you turn up like you don't care and you take her everywhere, you give her everything. And you, you don't even do what Mickey did and be nice to my face and roll your eyes behind my back. I'm pretty much nothing to you, and you make that so bleeding clear.
Hey, that's unfair. A bit unfair. Slightly unfair.
Sometimes, yeah, I worry that you're right, that I've missed chances. You don't just get one lucky shot in life, you get loads. It's seeing them, and this thing selling little fluffy knickknacks. Well, it's the lucky shot I saw. It's stupid, but all crazies are stupid. 6 months from now, it'll be, I don't know, glowing hedgehogs or elastic bands. But right now, it's glubby clubs. And they're my golden ticket, not to luxury, but maybe to offering Rose something better to come back to.
And on a last note, the music in this story is really, really good. I didn't notice it in the other box set stories, but Ian Morris and Rhys Downing do great work in Retail Therapy. If for whatever reason in the near future, Big Finish decide to release these stories separately as opposed to making you buy an entire box set for all four of them, then Retail Therapy is a must listen. Now to round off the Ninth Doctor's Big Finish stories before Christopher Eccleston returned to the role, we have two short trips, the first one being Battle Scars by Selim Ulug, released in the summer of 2019, and then Her Own Bootstraps by Amy Veers, released in autumn of 2020. Both of them work thematically as a double feature as they build on the same scene from Rose, where Rose is in Clive's den and looking at old archive photos of the Ninth Doctor, one of them being the Doctor with the Daniels family who cancelled their trip on the Titanic in 1912, and the other being a sketch of the Doctor on the day the volcano Krakatoa erupted in 1883. Battle Scars is narrated by Nicholas Briggs and starts with the Doctor's TARDIS landing in the garden of the Daniels family and an injured Doctor falling out, only to be nursed back to health by the family who take him in and show him real kindness. It's not really confirmed where in the Doctor's life this takes place as we never found out what injured the Doctor, but we know that it's really early days for him, and we know this because one of the Daniels' daughters, Connie, says fantastic. And this is where the Ninth Doctor picks up his fondness for the word. It has to take place after the bleeding heart because the Doctor has his blue-tipped screwdriver here, so he's not suffering from regeneration trauma, unless we just, for whatever reason, have to work around bleeding heart now. It could work as a post-regeneration story. He does utter the words no more in his sleep as he has nightmares of the Time War. Honestly, the only reason this doesn't work is because of the colour of the screwdriver. Anyway, the Doctor makes a speedy recovery with the Daniels, only to discover...
We'll all be setting out on a voyage next week.
Well, sounds wonderful, said the Doctor. Could be just the thing... Pausing, the Doctor's face darkening, he added, The 10th of April, 1912. Please, don't tell me.
In fact, said Arthur... We're to set sail on the Titanic for America, enjoy a holiday there, then return in a month's time.
He paused and added, Our Dr. Hodgkins recommended a complete change, said it would be good for what ails me. Connie stared at the Doctor, puzzled as he began to shake with anger. Abruptly, he got up and strode towards the back door.
Why me? He said, nearly shouting. Why should it always be me that has to play God?
The door slammed behind him. Shaking his head, Arthur said,
He's been in the wars. I don't know which battles or which war come to that. He wouldn't say, but there you have it.
Now, Battle Scars is a fine short story. If there's an issue here, it's that we have absolutely no idea where this Doctor came from and exactly why he has such conflict in regards to whether or not he should save the Daniels family. Yeah, the Titanic is probably a fixed point, but if the Daniels can be saved, then he wouldn't hesitate normally. Connie is able to talk the Doctor into making the right moral choice, but because we don't really get to explore why he's so conflicted, it kind of falls flat. I liked how the Daniels were characterised, though. You do really grow to like them and admire them. And there's a really good subplot where the Doctor investigates a rival to the family business who used to be a former friend, but they grew apart after the Boer War. In its own bubble, it's a nice subplot, but once again, we have another story which brings up the Ninth Doctor's experiences and parallels with the Time War, which is really, really feeling played out. Still, I do recommend it. And lastly, we have Her Own Bootstraps, which follows the Ninth Doctor once again dealing with the consequence of the Time War, as he steals a Time War weapon from Althea Bryce, a evil scientist who plans to use it for, well, evil. The Doctor decides to bury the weapon on Krakatoa so the eruption can destroy it. However, he encounters a younger, more innocent, and kinder version of Althea on the island who will just dig it up again. This is where Althea found the weapon in the first place. With the volcano about to erupt, the Doctor and the scientist find themselves trapped in a bootstrap paradox, and the Doctor has to somehow change a future that has already happened. First things first, Jacob Dudman narrates this and... is there really nothing he can't do? The guy has voiced 10, 11, and 12, can do great impressions of all of them, but he can also do 9 as well?
She looked back at the Doctor. We've met before. Or we will? I haven't met you before, so you must meet me in the future. And that leads you here somehow. The Doctor held up the metallic case to emphasize his point.
I stole this thing from your future self, he explained. You were working for mercenaries, reverse engineering weapons. I took it here to destroy it, and here you are now, ready to steal it to tinker with again. We're in a stable time loop, Althea, a bootstrap paradox. I bury this, you dig it up and take it home with you. Years later, when your lab's on contract with Valentari military unit, I'll steal it and come here to bury it where you'll be waiting to steal it, on and on and on and on forever. Several possible questions ran through Althea's brain. What's in the box? Why was I working with mercenaries? Why did you steal it from me? She settled on the question that had been bothering her since they first met. Who are you? I'm the Doctor.
And the premise of the Doctor trying to talk an evil genius down is good, but it feels like a retread of the Big Finish short trip Forever Fallen, and that's an especially bad story to be compared to because A, Forever Fallen is brilliant, and B, Forever Fallen is free to listen to. Her Own Bootstraps is a story that you have to pay for. That unfortunate piece of competition aside, Her Own Bootstraps is a decent story. It just feels like at this point we're in really well-worn and trodden territory. The story also feels too short to explore the premise. The solution seems way too easy for a paradox of this nature, and the arc of Althea just really didn't hit any notes for me. I don't know, maybe I'm just a bit tired at this point. I've listened to so much Ninth Doctor over the past few weeks. It was a really interesting dive into Big Finish, though, but the conclusion that I've reached is... they're way too reliant on a few singular traits of the Ninth Doctor. The wounded war veteran, the grumpy northern alien who calls humans stupid apes. Stories like Night of the Whisper, The Oncoming Storm, Human Conflict, Bleeding Hearts, The Other Side, and The Short Trips really hammer home this facet of the Ninth Doctor's character, and yeah, it is an important part of Nine that makes him unique as an incarnation. However, I'd argue that limiting yourself to that type of characterization does Nine a disservice, and the Ninth Doctor is more than just his trauma. It would be like if Big Finish did a load of audio adventures with the Sixth Doctor, but he's overcoming his regeneration and strangling everyone he meets. Like, yeah, it's part of the Sixth Doctor's character arc, I guess, but there's more to him than that. Because yeah, Nine was hurting and broken, but he was also capable of real care, empathy, understanding, moments of genuine joy, admiration, and a love of life. Even Eccleston himself knew that.
What a lot of the science fiction programmes we're going up against don't have is the kind of central message of Doctor Who, which is love life. You know, it's unashamedly emotional about... the Doctor's message seems to be, you have a short life, make sure it's a happy one and seize every moment and accept life in all its forms, which is a central message with him. You know, he doesn't react with horror when he sees a blue three-headed monster. He reacts with wonder, and I think that's a very important message to send out to children. And a lot of the series is a kind of the series you're talking about, Buffy, it's kind of postmodern irony and stuff, whereas this is this retains that kind of innocence, the innocence of its message.
I can't claim to speak for everyone, but that's the Doctor I fell in love with back in 2005, and I think that's why stories like Retail Therapy and, to a lesser extent, The Window on the Moor excel from this lineup. And from 2013 to 2020, that was The Ninth Doctor and Big Finish. However, in 2021...
Hello? Is there someone there? If you're hearing me now, I'm already dead, but that's all right. I've been dead before. There are worse ways to spend your day. The important thing is I'm coming back.
I always come back. I'll be there when you need me most, when you're lost and alone, when you're in distress, when the day seems bleak and the night never ends. I'll be your friend when there's no one else, and I'll fight for you when hope is gone. I'll hold your hand till the light fades.
My name is Christopher Eccleston, and I am playing the Doctor. It's a big universe out there, and you haven't even scratched the surface. Well, it's time to change that.